Approve the minutes, but I'd just like to welcome everybody, first of all, with Thanksgiving approaching. Some of us may not be working a full day next Wednesday, but we do have time on the Monday night City Council agenda. So we're going to make a decision on whether we're meeting tomorrow based on what transpires with the City Council. So we'll be getting back to folks on that. So we'll call the meeting to order, and anyone willing to move that we approve last week's minutes?
I'll move to do that.
Thank you, Sarah, second.
Yep.
Any questions or additions, comments? All right, thank you, patience. All in favor, indicate by raising your hand. All right, opposed? All right, thank you very much. And am I can't recall, am I able to share my screen?
I think you are.
You okay. Should be able to.
Give it a try.
So the first item we have is recommendations to the council. Last week we did some nice brainstorming, and that brainstorming is in the minutes. I also took my own personal notes and thought we could continue to brainstorm a little bit. This week's council meeting, we did not have a presence, but we are expected to be on the agenda for next Monday's. Is it a continuation of the meeting? Is that what happened, Karen?
That's correct.
Okay. And at the work session, just a reminder for everyone, we heard comments by counselors and were asked by the mayor to respond to those comments. And that's what we brainstormed last week. And I thought what might be helpful is that I share my screen. I took my own notes. They're very much abbreviated. And I thought that might help people with things they want to add. One thing I'd like to add, for example, is there's been recognition since we last met that in order to plan for, say, March, there's a need for the task force to be planning now. So one recommendation would be that we get quick action by the City Council on authorizing us to continue in whatever form that may be. So I'm going to share my screen now and try to pull that off. Me way too many options. Go with this one. I must have too many things open. All right, can folks see that?
We can. It looks like it's chopped off on the right. There we go. That looks good.
Okay. So the basic categories were size, new people, money, regular meeting times, reporting, committees, council membership, and council citizen response task force tenure, having to do with what increment of time should we be authorized. So I can type, patients can type. Let me ask Kim McNamara, did I spell Rich Dipentema correctly? I doubt it.
It's close.
No, I believe you did.
Wow. Okay.
I think the P is capital, but I'm not sure. Okay. Let me check.
Yeah.
And it's Pentima, I believe, IMA.
Yeah, that's correct. I have IMA as well. Yep.
All right, great. All right, so just very quickly on size, what I heard and noted was looking for certain skill sets, adding a healthcare professional, at least one, diversity of interest, industry, hospitality, people who want to be engaged in this process. People want to see at the table, look at mission first, then recruit to suit, update the charge. Rich D. Pentima, who had applied originally, was a suggested healthcare professional. We need sufficient bodies to staff subcommittees. So that was a comment encouraging the size to remain the same, at least. And then again, ID skill sets we need, arts and entertainment, health, hospitality, city event experience, designers. Health input is essential. So there seemed to be strong consensus there. Would anybody else like to add anything in this category? Okay, we'll keep moving.
I don't know if it belongs in that category, James. Maybe it belongs further down in committees, but yeah, I'll hold my thought for committees. Sorry.
Okay. So in under new people, we agreed to allow non-residents. In fact, we have a few already. And the suggestion was made to limit the percentage of non-residents, key functions not filled by residents, filled by non-residents. Any additions or changes there? Okay.
I don't see any.
So with respect to money, rather than having a budget like we did this year that we could work with, instead request money when we have a specific project that requires money from the council. There was a suggestion of an early winter appropriation and approve funds as needed or requested. I think this was an improvement on the first statement as a way to handle money that would work well. And then there was a comment, we don't know, which is, we really don't know what's gonna come up and what's gonna be needed. So maybe include a contingency amount for unforeseen events or needs. Any other suggestions regarding money?
James, this is Russ. Mm-hmm. I apologize I had to miss last week's meeting because it was on a Tuesday, but you know, my only concern with this section, I do, as a taxpayer and citizen, totally get the idea of this first point of rather than receive an amount of money, request money for a specific project. However, I worry that there's potential for that to allow politics to come into play when you have to go to the city council for each individual effort that the task force is achieving. And I think one of the eloquent aspects of this year's effort was that the city said the task force has X number of dollars to work with, and then we were able to work quickly and nimbly doing what we needed to do without getting bogged down in a situation where we were having to advocate for very, very specific things in a very public way. And my interpretation of what I've heard in the council meetings I've sat in over the past couple of months is, regardless of how anything has played out with anything the task force has done, unanimously it seems that the city council is happy with every single effort that we've undertaken, and they understand that you know, there are little issues here and there, but they understand that it has had a significant impact on the community. And I just don't want to put anything that's going to slow down the efforts of the task force next year. So I mean, the city council of course has it at its discretion how they want to allocate funds and how they want to do that, but I think that it was a really great way to put trust in the hands of the task force and remove any political element from the allocation of project funds, project by project, and allow the task force to work well. So that's my only concern seeing that. I do get why that's suggested. And I, you know, it's going to end up where it's going to end up. But I think the allocation of a fund that the task force is able to draw from is good. And the reality, and Karen, correct me if I'm wrong, but the reality is at the end of the day, if the task force approves expenditure for something that of those allocated funds, you know, it's not just like an automatic spend. The city council could come and say, whoa, 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 we need to talk about this at any point. So, because they do hold the purse strings. So I don't know if anyone has thoughts on that, but that's just my immediate reaction to that.
I would be the counter to that thought. Not that I don't agree with you, Russ, but something that came up at the work session was that any consideration of a task force 2.0 and a request for funds would require a specific breakdown of costs anticipated or monies to be sought. And I think to the point, we don't know what we don't know. It's hard to put forth a breakdown of costs if we're not sure what we plan to anticipate. I think the politics are such that it would be difficult for us to ask for another tranche of money without having certain costs identified. So.
Yeah, no, that's fair. And I understand that. I'll be interested to see how it plays out in the long run. You know, I think the city council very much put into the effort that they want it to be a non-political process. So my hope is that even with this in there, it remains that way. But no, thanks. That was my only comment. But however it ends up, you know, I'm supportive of it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Anybody else on money? Okay.
I see Kim's hand.
Could you let Toni McClellan into the meeting, please? She's still in the waiting room.
I think it's Jessica.
Oh, I'm sorry. My apologies.
No worries.
I haven't been given that power yet. Regular meeting time, we didn't have much to say to that. We've been meeting on Wednesdays. After some time, not too much time, the subcommittees have settled into their time slots. Would anybody like to add anything to that?
Nope.
Okay. No, ma'am. And then reporting, code minutes and packets was a suggestion, makes those minutes part of public record, or perhaps that's more accessible as public record or seen by more people.
I think if I can weigh in, I think the challenge is not that all this information exists, but we could make sure it's in one place and just make sure that everybody understands exactly where it is. Because I do think the information exists. We just have to present it in a comprehensive fashion. So
sorry to interrupt.
Yep, it's the YouTube, and we could certainly augment and make sure each day the page on the city website is up to date. And Stephanie has her hand up.
That's Stephanie.
So the challenge here is that everything exists on the Citizen Response Task Force page. It's updated as soon as the minutes are available, the videos are available, blah, blah, blah. So obviously the challenge is, how do we make sure that we can't make sure people look at it? So how do we raise the awareness, visibility of that? I have now created a banner on the homepage for a link to that page. So any other suggestions in terms of just how to let people know what has been there all along would be welcome.
I think in furtherance of how the subcommittees have worked and could continue to work, if the subcommittees could be consistent about posting their agendas or sharing them with Stephanie so that they can be part of this central site for information, that would be good.
Okay. All right, how about committees? We emphasize health committees instrumental.
James, if I could add here that I think the way the task force has been in many ways most nimble is in deciding what it should tackle on a subcommittee level. I think in a way the language of Task Force 2.0 should memorialize or formalize that subcommittees are a valuable resource available to the task force, and the task force should be empowered to create and sort of commission and decommission subcommittees as it sees fit based on the issues it's trying to tackle. I think the validity of the subcommittee work is just as important as the task force, and I think it should be understood by everybody that the task force somehow in some regards functions best when it breaks topics into subgroups and functions in that realm. I think it just to formalize the way subcommittees are created, uncreated, and what they tackle. That wasn't very eloquent, but maybe you know what I'm talking about.
I do.
Aaron, this is Russ. Are you speaking in terms of saying something much more general than giving the specific breakdown of health, streets, et cetera?
General to say the task force has within its purview the ability to decide what's worthy of subcommittee substance.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that's great.
Because I think that's where health came from. I think that they all were born organically from the task force, and I would want them to be seen as within the legitimate purview of the task force to be able to set these up.
I spell purview right?
I think so.
And so for example, when the health subcommittee was formed, it was in response to concerns by the task force that we weren't, we were focused on the Bridge Street lot and the streets, but were we focused on all the things we needed to be? And it was through a kind of an open-ended brainstorming session that idea for the health subcommittee was born.
Right, and I'm sure
Anne remembers that day that she agreed to chair that new committee. I think that's a good point. Thank you. Council membership. We got the blue ribbon analogy. We have a defined end start date, hopefully related to the end of the pandemic. Not necessary to include a counselor. Why is it important to include a counselor? So wrapped up in this is the desire to not politicize, for the committee to be very independent. Any other comments clarifying that?
I see Russ has unmuted himself. Russ?
Yeah, I feel like I'm talking too much, but I just want to say that I think the meetings are open to the counselors to attend at any time. Several counselors have sat in and observed the meetings, which is totally fine. So I don't know that there's any purpose to having a counselor having an actual seat on the task force. I think it's worked out really well. I agree. It's much more like a blue ribbon committee. This is not a standing, hopefully we'll be done with this soon, but it's not yet. So I don't think that there's any purpose or reason to have a counselor as either a voting member or an official member of the task force when they're able to sit in anytime they need to and they can view all the meetings.
And for that matter, I'd like to add that anyone is welcome to sit in on any meeting.
Exactly. Yeah, I agree.
Okay, anything else? Council membership? How about tenure? I bristled at the thought that we be authorized on a monthly or even 3-month basis. I don't think we can work that way. I think our project planning, our tasks, some take a long time, some not so much, but I don't think we can work in a incremental way.
James, I see Alan's hand up, and I want to put Kim on the spot as well. Alan?
I was just going to make the suggestion, perhaps we take a page from the mask ordinance extension that's being proposed, and say that the task force runs until the city council votes to close it.
So until we really,
because we don't know. We don't know what's going to be in 6 or 8 months. And I agree that month by month, we just doesn't make any sense. Quarter by quarter is not particularly useful. So run until it's not needed and the city council votes it to close.
I like that suggestion.
James, I was going to ask Kim her opinion on if this were to have a duration. It's not fair to ask, but if you were trying to set an end date for the useful life of this task force, Kim, would you be able to do that? What makes sense to you?
No, I wouldn't be able to do that, except for leaving it up pretty much like it's just been stated, because, you know, we're very hopeful that we have vaccine coming down the road, but that is only for vulnerable populations, healthcare workers, EMS, our disabled population, and elderly. And so even though we have vaccine coming and it sounds promising, we don't know when production will be enough so that we can vaccinate the entire population. There's going to be a lot of competition for it. So this might be a long-term thing for a year or more.
Okay. So any other suggestions on any topic here, or a new topic?
I see Anne's hand is raised, James.
Good, Anne with an E or Anne with no E?
Anne with no E.
Good, Anne.
I just wanted to mention that at the Health Subcommittee meeting yesterday, we also brought up Rich DiPentima's name. And would it be possible to have some kind of a formal recommendation from the task force to add him as a member? Kim went through more in more detail his credentials with us, and including time in our armed forces, time as a deputy public health director. I saw a letter from him today, a publicly available letter, and I noticed a PhD after his name, and he's also an RN. The list just seems to go on and on. So I wondered if there's some way we could formalize our interest in him as a member.
James, if I could add to that.
Mm-hmm.
Rich also has experience with outbreaks. So if you remember several years ago, we had the issue with SARS and there was an outbreak in Toronto. And we had direct flights from Toronto to Manchester. So there needed to be some local intervention there. Plus, I've worked things like meningitis clinics with Rich before. So he really understands exactly what we're talking about. He's lived it.
All right, I'd like to ask a general question about how new people are added. You know, we were formed through a city council process. Is our recommendation that the city council advance that same process, or do we have an opinion about how we backfill our vacancies?
James, it's Russ again. I believe the mayor appointed all of us, and it was, right. You know, we would apply and the mayor would make the appointment. And it seems I don't see any reason to change that process. I think that, you know, based on the peers that are in the room, I think he did a good job, and see no reason why it shouldn't stay the way that the city council set it up, where people have the ability to apply and the mayor approves it. I think that if task force members have specific people in the community that they think would do an excellent job on the task force, you know, we could take it upon ourselves to go out and speak to them and encourage them to apply, and then maybe write a letter of support to the mayor as an individual who serves on the task force, but as a citizen. I don't see any problem with that unless Karen sees an issue with that, but I think that's probably the best process.
All right, anybody else on that? And then I think we should probably move on.
Only one other point, similar to what the city manager had raised, you know, is there potential for individuals to serve in a volunteer capacity on a subcommittee while maybe being approved to the broader task force? I don't know if this is something that we would make a recommendation on so that we can continue to move ahead if someone like Rich could provide input into the health subcommittee while the process of applying to be a formal member of the task force could be managed at the council level.
Sarah, do you mean having people who are not task force members serve on subcommittees?
I guess the question is that something that would be beneficial, and part of my challenge with making recommendations here is it's not clear to me, you know, how much governance and purview the council who formed the task force should say this is how you should continue to operate versus us making recommendations. And if we have a recommendation for how we operate differently, I think it should be with a background in why we're making that recommendation. I'm just trying to think if we have somebody that wants to join, like what's the process for applying to the task force, getting approval, what's the lead time between when somebody might be interested and able to participate versus when they're formally approved.
Kathy has her hand up, James.
If I could just dovetail on that, we know that Anne has elected not to continue, which is a great loss for the health subcommittee. And I feel really strongly that the sooner we can get someone onto the subcommittee to just kind of overlap with Anne's tenure, the easier it will be for us to continue to work and move forward as opposed to doing a lot of just kind of catch up on what the group has been doing. So even though it might just be a special circumstance, I would be very interested in seeing if we could move on Rich DiBentima.
I had penciled you in, Kathy, as the next chair.
Good luck.
Okay, so I think we have to wrap this up, but if people have additional ideas, you can suggest them anytime between now and next Monday.
I see Ann Weidman's hand up, Ann with an E, James.
Okay.
Ann with an E. I mean, you know, I'm that person. I'm like Rich, I guess. I'm not officially here, but I'm always here. If obviously Rich is going to move forward, why doesn't he just start to log in so he can come up to speed? There's nothing preventing him from doing that.
Rich can ANW now. I'll fix that later. All right. So let's move on to Anne with no E for the health subcommittee report. I can't hear you yet.
No.
All right, and we're gonna let you work on your technical difficulties. I haven't heard, usually Mark makes some noise when he joins us. Has he joined us?
I don't see him, and I can report that the street use subcommittee did not meet. We're really, we feel like we're in a holding pattern pending further guidance or recommendation from the council.
Okay. And Russ, you have Encore. I know there's been some activity around Bridge Street in terms of financials. Would you mind updating the task force on that?
Not at all. Mark and I met with a few of the board members of Pop-Up NH on Sunday morning, and they have all their books and everything that they're putting together, but over the past week they've been working on getting everything off the lot, and we made a decision that we thought that we wanted to share the most accurate numbers possible with the task force and with the committee. So beyond the preliminary report that I gave 2 weeks ago, they're taking the time right now to put together a more detailed report that will provide some information that the council has asked for. But we want to make sure that we get it right the first time. Their fiscal year doesn't end until the end of March. So, you know, it's unusual to try and put together, wrap up all the numbers with a bow in the middle of a fiscal year, but they're, I think, doing a good job of getting an understanding of how everything went this year, especially since the project has come to a close now. So I'm hoping that, you know, in the next week or two, we'll have final numbers from them. Mark and I had said to them that we definitely want to try and see if we can get, you know, something for very early December. So that's what we're looking at for that. But the lot's now completely empty. The project's wrapped. And, you know, we're proud of what they did and happy with how it all ended up. We just need to wrap up all the numbers now and be able to share with the community what happened. But I can tell you that the economic impact was meaningful. And we heard that in the city council meeting 2 weeks ago when Evan Mallett, the owner of the Black Trumpet, got on with the city council onto the call and said that if the pop-up had not happened this year, he seriously doubts his business would still exist today. And if that isn't an endorsement for the efforts of the task force, I don't know what is. So that's all the time I can take up today, but we'll have more information soon.
Great.
Unless anyone has a question, but thank you.
Any questions for Russ?
Don't see any.
Okay. And should we do a voice check?
And it could be your earbuds. I'm guessing it's your earbuds. You might want to unplug and see if you have audio then.
Yeah, I didn't have them on though. I just put them on because you couldn't hear me before. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you now.
I'm just going to lean in. I didn't have them on earlier either when you could hear me. I don't know what went wrong. I apologize.
We can hear you loud and clear. Oops.
Can you see my screen?
Not yet.
I'm clicking on share screen and nothing seems to be happening. Jessica, is my screen sharing enabled?
Yes, it is enabled.
So now one thing, it's another.
If you can email it to one of us and we can try and share it if you're having trouble. Oh, there we go.
Oh, you're great. Good.
Thank you.
All right, here we go. The weekly dashboard, what can I say? It speaks for itself. The graphs continue to show upward trends. Let's start at the top. The positivity, I do want to mention, I know we've discussed this before, but I just want to mention again that there are different methods for calculating positivity. So we've decided to stick with what we've been doing so that you can look at last week versus this week. But if you look at other sources, you may see other numbers, and I'll give you an example of that shortly. But what's important, I think, is the clear trend from week to week that the positivity is going in the wrong direction along with most of the data sets. As you can see, the case numbers are listed here for the state, the county, and the city. And you can see on the map, we had some vestiges of moderate community transmission in two counties last week. Now the entire state is showing substantial community transmission. And going down to these graphs showing the infections in both the state and the county continue to rise. The hospitalizations and infections also continue to rise. So demonstrating that this is not just a feature of increased testing or any other artifact, but that it is a real problem. And moving down then to take a broader look going across our neighbors in Massachusetts and Maine as well. We now have uncontrolled spread in New Hampshire and Massachusetts. Maine has been put into the trending poorly category. And as a reminder, the cases now are showing as new cases per million, not per 100,000, as you might see elsewhere. And then the positivity ratings. And here's an example of where you're seeing a difference. The last 14 days rolling average in New Hampshire is showing here, going from 2.2% up to 8%. Whereas you're seeing lower number, you were seeing lower numbers up above. And here is the 8% again in this graph in the lower right, the New Hampshire specific data. On the lower left, again, it's just a matter of the curves rising and the state being all in that darkly shaded, what would be considered a high rate of transmission and a high number of cases. And then the national map showing evidence of the same kinds of situation, particularly still in the Midwest.
Boy, it's really filled in the color. It's not even spotty anymore.
It has, and with the holidays coming up, I think.
We just lost your audio a little bit, Ann. Just
closer to the screen, Ann. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's pretty obvious when you look at the dashboard, and of course, with the holidays coming up, I know that Stephanie has been working on some public service announcements and publicity, and elsewhere, you know, national news media, magazines. On television, we're seeing lots of advice not to travel for Thanksgiving, not to celebrate outside of your bubble. I know that pandemic fatigue is setting in, along with a desire to celebrate the holidays, and also some excitement about the vaccines. But you know, it's going to take a while, as Kim has already said, for these to roll out and filter down to the general public. So it's not the time to lose any sense of vigilance that we need to maintain here.
And this is Russ. Can I ask a question about the top of your chart here at all the way at the top of the handout? Looking at the Rockingham County numbers, am I reading this last week to this week? Okay, I wasn't reading it correctly. It looks like there's a 28% increase, I guess, from last week to this week. I thought that was an overall increase for the year. All right. Thank you. That makes sense to me. I read it too quickly. Still, 25 week over week, 25% is huge.
Something like positivity. Kim has, I've heard her say this a number of times, in something like positivity, even a tenth or a few tenths of a percentage difference can really means be very meaningful. So yeah, this is alarming.
Yeah.
Since we've started our meeting, there are news reports now that New York City schools will close tomorrow because their 7-day positivity average threshold of 3% has been crossed. So more not good news.
Unless there's anything else, the other main item that I wanted to discuss was I sent this out last night, and I know we had discussed giving 48. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. We had discussed giving 48 hours for you to review any new documents. We're making some changes to the daily live FAQ that was just approved recently. So even though you weren't given 48 hours, I'm hopeful that everyone will be in favor of this. Honestly, I'm not even certain that it reaches the level of revision that needs approval, but I decided to err on the side of caution and make sure everyone on the task force had a chance to look at this. Whoops, that's not what I wanted to show you. Can you see some yellow highlight on your screen now?
No.
Now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. In the daily life FAQ, there are two places where we really don't have a choice. We felt compelled to make the same change in two places. As you may have heard, I believe it was on the 12th of November, The state of New Hampshire announced that they would no longer be conducting contact tracing on every case of COVID-19 in the state, but they will be limiting it to certain circumstances at this point in time. I know that's being challenged. I just saw a letter today that Stephanie shared with us. An organization called, I think it's the Science and Public Health Task Force of New Hampshire, has challenged this decision. But for now, it stands. And so only certain populations will be reliably subject to contact tracing. And we felt that it was important to make that clear in our daily life FAQ, which previously said that there would be contact tracing on all cases. So again, this impacted two sections of the daily life FAQ, the definitions section and then the section on contact tracing. In addition, as we just discussed with the need to maintain vigilance and be especially careful during the holidays, Stephanie had proposed that we add something to basic safety and what we should do to keep households safe. And we already had something in here, a graphic saying to avoid the three C's, crowds, closed spaces, and close contact settings. We just added a sentence or two to sort of provide more rationale for this with just a reminder in plain and simple and brief language as to how the virus spreads and why it's important to avoid contact with people outside of your bubble. So that's it for the daily life FAQ. And I don't know if it, again, if it reaches the level where we need to take a formal vote, but I did want to at least show it and maybe get the chair's opinions on whether we need to have a motion and a vote on these changes.
Does anybody have any questions for Ann about the changes?
See no hands.
Okay. So why don't you unshare for a moment, Ann? All right. So why don't, with an abundance of caution, why doesn't somebody make a motion that we approve those in second?
I'll make that motion.
Russ, in a second.
I'll second.
Thank you. All right. Any additional questions or comments? All right. All those in favor, raise your hand. Okay, opposed? All right, great. Anything else, Ann?
Yes, just finally and quickly, to my chagrin, I forgot to mention this during the health subcommittee meeting yesterday, but Kim and Bianca were present on the chamber chat on Friday and were representing our health subcommittee. So I just wanted to thank them again for that. And that's everything. Oh,
okay.
Yeah, that's everything. Thank you.
All right, well, I have a quick question, and this is a crystal ball, but, you know, the force of Thanksgiving for people to maintain their traditions seems very strong, as opposed to people, say, doing something very different thing this Thanksgiving. Maybe this is for the health committee, maybe for Kim. Do you have a sense, based on what you're reading or seeing, that, you know, Thanksgiving is not going to go well? You know, that people are traveling, that, you know, there's multi-generational gatherings, you know, is pretty much the definition of Thanksgiving. People are in overloaded in single family homes or apartments. That aren't particularly well ventilated. So it kind of meets those criteria of people being indoors, in close contact for a long period of time, likely not wearing masks because they're eating and drinking. What's the word out there on how Thanksgiving's gonna go?
I think I was just going to say, I think it was directed at me, but I saw Stephanie's hand and Kim's. I'll just say I'm worried and then pass it on.
Go ahead, Kim.
My apologies, Ann. So there are no indicators that are good right now in any realm. And no one should expect that we're going to get through Thanksgiving safely if there's the amount of traveling that I guess AAA is saying is still expected, and Stephanie can expand on that. But we're not talking about groups of 10 people or more as being risky. We're talking about people, groups of two that don't live in the same household that is risky right now. There's far more infection out there than the numbers capture, because there's always a lag. You know, it takes 5 days to before you should take a PCR test, and then it can take up to 5 days for that to be resulted and another amount of time to be reported. And so you can expect that there's far more infection out in our community than our residential numbers show, because the state numbers only report Portsmouth residents who are, you know, currently infected. There's a whole lot more people that come into Portsmouth for a various other reasons, you know, school or to shop or to eat out or to get health care or to come to work. And so I'm extremely worried about Thanksgiving, and to the point where it's really hard. I have a grandson I so much want to see, and I'm just not going to see him for the reasons that you talk about, that you cannot do Thanksgiving dinner safely because you cannot eat with a mask. And you generally don't stay at least 6 feet away from each other. And particularly with people traveling from areas that are even higher rates than ours, I'm very worried. Stephanie, I don't know if you want to follow up.
Just to say that we're actually working on an op-ed by Kim to go in Seacoast Online as soon as possible that says exactly that. Don't do it. And it's the next 4 months, because there aren't instant solutions once we get through Thanksgiving. So that's where we are.
All right. Any other questions?
I'm going to jump in real quick, if that's okay, James. This is Russ. I want to sincerely thank Ann, Kathy, and Bianca, and everyone on the health committee working with Kim and her department. I worry that sometimes it's going unnoticed that a wealth of professional expertise is being provided to the city by volunteers who are experts in their field. And I worry when I hear comments at the city council level about discontinuing a health subcommittee at the height of a pandemic. So I, for one, as a task force member, want to express my appreciation for all that you're doing. And I think that it's incredibly important. And these conversations should continue to happen as we go through this process. So thank you for all you do.
For what it's worth, and for those of you who didn't attend or watch that council meeting, I made a point to say that the health subcommittee in particular has been invaluable as a resource to the very taxed and very limited resources of our wonderful three-person health department. And that's not to diminish the many talents of Kim, Kristen, and Tony. It just added to the wealth and the depth and breadth. So,
thank you for those comments, and thank you to the health committee.
And thank you, James, for your expertise in ventilation. That's critical as well.
Thank you. Well, I know one of the unfortunate things in terms of membership on that committee is we don't have the privilege of sharing good news yet. So we'll look forward to that day. Okay. So we can finish early unless somebody wants to return back to something earlier that they wanted to say something and didn't get a chance to. All right, accept the motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you, Jim.
I'll second.
Thank you. Okay, all those in favor?
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks so much.